Good morning, Shiloh. Good to see you this morning. It is May the 24th. Our lesson for today coming up will be to practice justice and repent of injustice, coming from the book of Jeremiah, chapter 22, verses 1 through 10. Some things, as usual, that you might want to have with you. Your book, if you have one, definitely a Bible in any form or any translation. Some notepaper to take notes on, pen, pencil, or again, if you have your phone, tablet, or whatever you're using to view in this morning. But before we go any further, let us pray. Eternal God, we come to you right now in the name of Jesus, and we thank you. We thank you again for the breath of life, just for having the opportunity to break bread with your word this morning. Father, we pray that no matter where we're at, whether on computer, phone, TV, however we're getting this message, Father, we ask that you would bless us this morning, Father. I'd ask that you use me, Father. Pour into me even right now, Father. Use me as you will, and may you be given the glory, and your word bear much fruit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, tomorrow will actually be Memorial Day, so I would imagine that after Sunday school and church later on, many of you might start your pre-holiday weekend barbecuing. Maybe you did it yesterday. But it is important to remember, because time is kind of slipping away from us, what is Memorial Day? What will you be doing? Some people say it's the unofficial beginning of summer. Kind of weird with this coronavirus going on, but its true purpose is that you may notice a lot of commercials and different things that it's a holiday that is a federal holiday to remember those that fell in battle and sacrifice for their nation. And so for those that served, thank you, and for those that gave the ultimate sacrifice, we want to remember them as well. And that actually does kind of tie into our lesson a little bit. Our aims for today for the lesson, there are three. One, we want to recognize. So I want you to see that the covenant relationship between God and his people always required justice. So it wasn't just about keeping those Ten Commandments or the books or the laws of Leviticus. Hidden within them and buried within them at the core was love and justice. We also want to use that word repent. Deacon White a few weeks ago really hammered that home, but I want to come back to it. And we want to repent of injustice, that if we are practicing injustice, which is the lack of justice, we want to seek to turn away from that and to deliver the oppressed. And then to do the third one, the action is we want to become active agents of deliverance for the oppressed. So for those that are suffering from injustice, we want to do something about it. But the key is, I think we first have to look at it in terms of we have to free ourselves and be first partakers. So we need to start practicing justice before we can call on the government. So this lesson has two parts to it. It has sort of what's known as a macrocosm, a big picture view. That's where we look at the world, the government, and we can say, you know, city council, the governor, the president. But then there's also what's known as a microcosm. That's a smaller view of you, and it starts with you before it ripples outward. So everything will have two levels, a micro and a macrocosm view. So think about yourself, but also think big picture and then how you fit into it. Amen? The Bible truth. God never fails, and neither does his justice. And I know what you're thinking right now, if we've gone through this before, then why is there so much injustice in the world? I hear you. The problem is this. God never fails, but man does. Man falls short because many people, as we've seen throughout the Old and the New Testament, have a head knowledge of God, but they need a heart knowledge of God. My pastor that I grew up under used to say, Brother Jones, he said, a lot of people are about 12 inches from heaven. And I would say, what is that supposed to mean? And he'd say, that's about the distance from your head to your heart. They think they're gone, but they really aren't, because he's not in their heart. So a lot of the world has a heart problem. So we want to talk about a heart condition today a little bit. In fact, the great Russian novelist, Dostoevsky, he struggled with this, and he once said, how do I get faith from my head to my heart? What an interesting statement. Israel and Judah had that same problem. They knew what God wanted. They just hadn't resolved to do it. They didn't want to repent. They didn't want to turn from their ways and go towards his. Over the last few weeks, we've been moving around and looking at that word justice. And Deacon White brought up last week, justice isn't something that we just get. It's something that we do. We're justice, and we have to live it out. I'll give you a good example. The famous Mahatma Gandhi from India. There was some trouble between Pakistan and India. India mostly Hindu, Pakistan mostly Muslim, and they were fighting in this border territory, and the people were killing each other in large numbers and ruling over each other in harsh ways. So he went there and went on a hunger strike, and he got between them. And he began talking and preaching to them, and then a guy came up to him and said, "Teacher," he said, "I have to make a confession. In my anger, I killed a Muslim man, and now the boy is left behind is an orphan. How do I make it right? How do I practice justice?" And Gandhi said, "It won't be easy, but here's what you need to do. Take the boy into your home, feed him, clothe him, do everything that you can." And the man was kind of shuddered at that. He said, "I'll do my best." And he said, "I'm not done. You have to raise him as a Muslim, because that's what his father would have done. That's what makes it right." Deacon White brought up last week the difference between equality and equity. The equity would be taking the boy's life and making it whole, and then the man walked away and said, "The cost is too high, it's too great." Throw aside the whole issue of Hindu and Muslim, but the point is justice just too expensive? Does it require too much? And is that why you don't see a lot of it? Most people won't pay the cost for true justice. It's simply just too expensive. Does justice move? Have you ever been accused of being unjust? Have you ever cheated, lied, stolen something, defrauded someone? I know I have, and it still stays with me. The truth is, following Christ and living righteously, it does cost us. He told us it would. Jesus even told us in Luke 14:27, you might want to jot that down, Luke 14:27, he said, "Whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple." If you're following Christ, you have to live righteously. You have to live and practice justice. You have to nail those things to the cross. And in fact, in Luke 9:23, he says, "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me." And remember, the cross is the instrument of destruction and death. In Jesus' case, of sin, but for us, the sin and the things that keep us separated from him. You've got to put those things to death. The truth is, you are required daily to die to your flesh, to give up the things that you want, to live justly. And as we have seen over these last few weeks, Israel and Judah refuse to do that. Choose to turn away and gain heart knowledge of God and move it from your head to your heart. What does it really mean to repent? And as we get ready to get into the actual scripture text, I'm going to apply something, and I'll give you a moment to make sure you have your pen or your pencil, or if you're typing on your tablet or your phone. I'll speak slowly and I'll slow it down so that you can get these things. But the world has always struggled with this message of repentance and turning away from their ways and towards God's word. Thomas Watson was a Puritan scholar in the 17th century, and he wrote about, well, how do you repent? Because he was preaching that message back then, and people were struggling with, well, what do you mean by that? And what he found was there are six ingredients that make up the recipe for true repentance. And I'm going to give you these, and I want you to jot these down, and then you can use them later because they're kind of going to be part of your homework on the back end. Number one, to practice true repentance, and again, you'll notice Judah and Israel did not do these things, which was why they ended up the way that they did. Number one, you have to make sight of sin. Do you know when you see it? The prodigal son in Luke 15, he said, "I'll go back to my father and say, 'Father, I've sinned against you and against heaven.'" He realized that, oh, I see what I've done. That's the first step in repentance. Do you even realize what you've done? Now, sometimes we lie about it. You know, I've got five kids, and forever, I thought there was somebody in my house. I was like, I don't know, wasn't me. Because if something was broken or missing, you would ask over and over again. And the answer was always, I don't know, wasn't me. And I thought, boy, he gets into a lot of stuff, that fella. I think he's still around. He lives in a lot of people's houses, because sometimes we don't want to make sight of sin. Because if we recognize and say that we see it, we have to do something about it. Number two, after you see it, what's your reaction to seeing it, knowing that you're party to it? Is there sorrow for your sin? In 2 Colossians 7, Paul brings that up and he says, godly sorrow produces repentance that leads to salvation without regret. After you see it, is there sorrow? Do you feel some sort of reaction to it, that you realize that, wow, I've done damage? If you go back to the prodigal son, there was a sorrow where he realized, he said, I've sinned against my father and I've sinned against heaven. That led him to make a change. Number three, there's a confession of the sin. Not only do you feel sorry for it, because sometimes we can feel sorry, but we won't take ownership for it. Go back to Genesis. Adam, where art thou? His response was, he didn't own up to it. He knew he had sinned, but he hid. And over again, we see that throughout text. James 5 says, confess your sins one to another and pray for one another that you may be healed. So in order to take ownership for it so that God can fix it, we have to confess it. We have to take ownership for it. Four, is there a shame of sin? Now we know the Bible says there's no more condemnation, but that feeling that we know that sin is wrong, that we have to take ownership for that, and we could go on and on. When prodigal son says, Father, I've sinned against heaven and you, and he says, I am no longer worthy to be called your son. He bore the full weight of knowing what he had done was wrong, and he was now ready to turn away from it. That feeling that Jesus felt on the cross when he says, why have you forsaken me? That the cost of sin was great and it separates us from God. And that's that feeling that you get. That's a part of repentance. But then five, if we're honest, to get back with God, is there a hatred of that sin? Proverbs 8 says, the fear of the Lord is hatred of evil. Pride and arrogance in the way of evil and perverted speech I hate. Romans 9 says, hate what is evil and hold fast or cleave to what is good. Do you hate sin? Because I'm going to ask you to think throughout this lesson that the idea of practicing injustice is such a big thing, but are you trapped in a sin? Or is there a sin you're struggling with that keeps you separated from God and keeps you from doing and living righteously? Because if there is, today might be your day for breakthrough. So use these steps. And first, you've got to make sight of sin, be sorrowful for your sin, confession of the sin, be honest about what you're doing. Is there shame for sin where you realize it's not God's will for you? Five, hatred of that sin. You know, I know people have told me that they've smoked for years or they drank and they finally got to the point where they said, Lord, take away my taste and my desire for this. And now they say that I can't stand the smell of smoke. I can't stand alcohol. It makes me sick to my stomach. That sometimes in order to repent, we have to get to that point. And then the final point, turning from sin and returning back to God. Deacon White did an illustration a couple weeks ago where he turned his back and said that simply turning a 360 won't do it, because you're right back where you started from. This is a complete 180, the opposite of where you're headed and turning back to God. Because if you're turning back to God, you were going the opposite direction from him. So turning from your sin and returning back to God, because sin is the total opposite direction from where God is. In fact, in Acts 20, we see that they talked about repentance toward the God of our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Repentance just isn't denying sin. It's desperately clinging to God and his kindness, his forgiveness, and his grace. Now that was a lot, and hopefully you got all six of those jotted down, because those steps, and I want you to look for them today, embedded within the scripture text. But the great Christian writer A.W. Tozer, I want you to listen to this. He says, because we talked about the condition of the heart, and that being at the middle of repentance and having heart knowledge versus head knowledge. He says, in every Christian's heart, there is a cross and a throne. And the Christian is on the throne till he puts himself on the cross. If he refuses the cross, he remains on the throne. Perhaps this is at the bottom of the backsliding and worldliness among the gospel believers today. We want to be saved, but we insist that Christ do all the dying. There's no cross for us, no dethronement, no dying. We remain king within the little kingdom of man's soul and wear our tinsel crown with all the pride of Caesar. But we doom ourselves to the shadows and weakness of spiritual sterility. If you've been watching the news, the young man, I believe in Georgia, Ahmaud Arbery, father and son were chasing him because he was jogging and they thought he was a criminal. So they went after him and they ended up shooting and killing him. There's a church group somewhere online. They're raising money for the father and son's defense. A church group, because they're saying that he's being treated unfairly and unjustly. And when I saw it, my heart sank. I don't know who these people are, what kind of church they profess to be in. But if you're a believer in Christ, this is how injustice, even in the church, or in a nation that claims to be under God, actually chooses to be over God from its birth until its death. It's hard to reconcile those things, and it brings us back to the keep in mind verse for this week. It says, this is what the Lord says, be fair-minded and just. Do what is right. Help those who have been robbed. Rescue them from their oppressors. Quit your evil deeds. Do not mistreat foreigners, orphans, and widows. Stop murdering the innocent. That's from Jeremiah 22:3. There's a lot of that going on in the world, and God is not pleased. Do not mistreat foreigners, orphans, widows, and stop murdering the innocent. A man jogging. And the authorities tried to cover it up. But justice will be served. But maybe the biggest insanity of all is, as I just shared with you, church groups and people are denying justice and saying, and making up every excuse to say that it was okay to kill a man in cold blood. Heart knowledge versus head knowledge. You know, in today's lesson, in the In Focus, if you have your book, grab onto that, and if not, then I'll read it for you. Last week, Deacon White talked about building on a foundation, or if you build and God is not in the planning, you build in vain, you plan in vain. Everything that we do is in vain if we don't have God as part of the plan. It says, Quincy Farm was a beautiful place. There were horses to ride, chickens to feed, and a wonderful petting zoo with a few exotic animals. The groundskeeper and the farm manager were excellent to work for, and the staff was friendly and fun. School children and tourists would visit the farm. People enjoyed the sweet corn grown on the Quincy farm, and everyone purchased some before they left the farm. Mr. Quincy loved the farm more than anything. His family would try to have him slow down and just enjoy the farm, but he would not. If he wasn't walking, talking, or coming up with a new plan for visitors to enjoy the farm, then things weren't going right. His best friends warned him that one day it could be taken away. He needed to relax and thank the Lord for his blessings. Mr. Quincy told them to stop talking such foolishness. God would never take his farm away. Even after he died, he knew his family would maintain the farm just fine. One day, strong winds and heavy rains came and the forecast looked bad. Mr. Quincy knew that he could keep the farm afloat for about 3 days, but if it lasted longer than that, he would lose the farm. After a week of torrential downpours, Mr. Quincy's beloved farm was ruined. Mrs. Quincy saw her husband shed a tear as he looked up to the sky. And I guess the question that comes out of that is, like Israel and Judah, what do you hold on to so dearly? How would you react if you lost something you deeply cherish? What would your response be? Would you still praise God? Would you be like Job and say that the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away? Or would you become bitter? Would your knowledge of God revert back to your head from your heart? Book of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 19 through 21. This is from a New Living Translation, but Matthew 6, 19 through 21. So you may want to jot that down, or if you're looking, I'll give you a moment to find it. So Matthew 6, 19 through 21. And it reads as such. Don't store up treasures here on earth, where moths eat them and rust destroys them, where thieves break in and steal. Store your treasures in heaven, where moths and rust cannot destroy, and thieves do not break in and steal. And oh, listen to this. 21, wherever your treasure is, the desires of your heart will be also. Heart knowledge. Mr. Quincy loved his farm more than God. And when the farm was taken, what was left? Did he have any room for God in the beginning at all? I can't answer that. I think we're seeing this now during this COVID-19 pandemic. We're being tested and allowed to see, where is our heart? Where's our treasure? Heart knowledge versus head knowledge. The text for this week, and it deals with that, but it deals also with the injustice, which is tied to the heart. And we go back, and it continues on with last week with a different turn. It takes place in Jerusalem. We know that Jerusalem was the capital of Judah, and really of the whole nation, but Israel had been already separated out, and Judah was hanging on, but they're being assailed by, as we learned last week, Babylon. And as we see this, God had promised David that there'd always be somebody in his lineage on the throne. Now, be careful of that, because we might be thinking human, but remember, Jesus is born out of that line, and so God is never slack or untrue in his word. But many people hung on to that, and if you go back and you read through Kings and Chronicles, you'll see over and over again that Israel and Judah, Judah did a little bit better job than Israel, but not much. But the people, again, had even lost the word when they found it in the temple. Some of the deacons, we were talking about that earlier. How did they know what God wanted if they didn't know what he had said? They were living on the testimony of their parents and on the fact that they were God's chosen people. Sometimes we do that even today. And we'll say that Shiloh was 100 and some years old. That's by God's hand, not by ours. That won't save anyone. That won't cover anyone. We've been blessed because God wanted to bless us, not because of anything that we've done. And as you look at that, through this royal line of all these kings in the city of David, many of them still believed that God would not allow this to happen, even though the prophets had said so. And Jeremiah, as we saw last week, had delivered a pretty stern word and said exactly what was going to occur. Now, the background for this week is, so again, we don't have to beat Jeremiah into the ground. This week's lesson changes just a little bit because as they're getting ready to get sent away, they begin talking more about what exactly is going to happen. And this week, you'll see that the prophet offers the old famous saying, I got some good news and I got some bad news. Hey, Shiloh, I got something for you. I got good news and bad news. Which one would you want first? Would you want the good news first or the bad news? I'm not sure how I would do that. I'd probably take the bad news first and then save the good stuff for later. No right or wrong answer, but good news and bad news. Which one do you usually get first? Well, let's check this out. See what Jeremiah says in verses 1 through 5. See if it's good news or bad news. This is from a New Living Translation. This is what the Lord said to me. go over and speak directly to the king of Judah. Say to him, listen to this message from the Lord, you king of Judah, sitting on David's throne. Let your attendants and your people listen too, because sometimes the king would get a message and it would only be whispered into his ear. But this message is for everyone. And as pointed out last week, Deacon White did a good job of pointing out that the king, often because he was the head, and this goes back to the book of when Samuel asked the people, are you sure you want a king? That however the king went, so went the nation. So that if the king fell short, he was responsible. Harry Truman used to keep a plaque on his desk that said, the buck stops here. So I'm the president, I'm in charge. You know, if I go up, we go up, and if I go down, we go down. And this is the same case, spiritually and otherwise. So he says, listen, you king, and the attendants and the people listen too. This is what the Lord says. Be fair-minded and just. Do what is right. Help those who have been robbed. Rescue them from their oppressors. Quit your evil deeds. Do not mistreat foreigners, orphans, and widows. Stop murdering the innocent. If you obey me, there will always be a descendant of David sitting on the throne here in Jerusalem. The king will ride through the palace gates and chariots and on horses with his parade of attendants and subjects. But if you refuse to pay attention to this warning, I swear by my own name, says the Lord, that this palace will become a pile of rubble. That good news or bad news? Maybe a little bit of both. I think the good news is that God is willing to relent a little bit. He says, if you do these things, I will keep somebody on the throne. But it does kind of remind us that there are some conditions. One of them is, don't harm people just because you can. These points capture what God wants from the government of Judah and even America. It is addressed to the leadership because they're responsible. If they lead the people, hopefully we'll follow. It is important to note that people will suffer because of bad leadership at every level. We should note that Swiftly moves past this passage and gets into the idea of, well, what is God doing here? It's important to show that those who use their power appropriately or inappropriately, that it further pushes the downtrodden or increases obstacles for people to get things. I saw an article yesterday that said 40% of people in lower income brackets have lost their jobs during this coronavirus pandemic. And yet a lot of the money that's being passed out is help money. Big businesses are taking and other people that don't need it. And these are the things that God is not pleased with. He wasn't pleased then and he's not pleased now. And it, like he said, that his fury, that it burns, that this is an opportune time to make equity, not inequality. Sometimes we say, well, sometimes things are different places around the world. God's word is universal and it goes everywhere. Now, when you were a kid, you probably used to go over a friend's house. They probably had different rules, but there were some things that were universal. But I'll never forget, I had a friend growing up, he used to curse at his mom. And like my jaw would like hang open and I would be amazed because I would think, I don't think that's right anywhere, and it isn't. And as you look at that, you know, in some countries women have to wear head coverings or scarves, and there are certain rules about what people can do. I came across this story that kind of adds a little bit of flavor to that. It's called House Rules. You probably thought your mom and dad were so mean because they had such high expectations. And I'm sure Israel probably looked around and said, how come everybody around us doesn't have to do what we have to do? Our God is so demanding. We can't do this, we can't do that. Nobody else cares for foreigners. Nobody else has to care for orphans and widows. Other people, like in Babylon, Assyria, they do whatever they want, when they want, but our God is so hard that he's always, and so they chose to take the easy way out. They didn't want to die to themselves. But now God was withdrawing from them. But I want to share this story with you. And it says, this guy says, I met my buddy Sam, like when we were in high school. And as we got acquainted, Sam would complain about how unjust his father was. As Sam and I got closer, we would visit each other's houses, and I began to see why Sam was frustrated. His father was very critical and demanding. One day, Sam said, "I wish my dad was more like your dad." Ironically, my dad said the same thing Sam's dad did. The only difference was their approach. My father prioritized and helped me understand why we had the house rules that we did and how they worked for my own good. Jeremiah tried to help the leaders of Judah see there were good reasons why God demanded they do what they do. If he couldn't get their attention through prophecy, through the prophet, then he would get their attention through prophecy. That if they wouldn't change, he would change them. And we've seen over the last couple of weeks, it's a two-step process. If you won't change on your own, he will change you. First, with a whooping. You'll be taken over by outsiders, and the Babylonians were coming. And then two, you would be sent to your room. They were being sent away. What does it take for God to get your attention and for you to follow his rules? It is not what we say, but often how it's said. The prophet gave them one last final warning. He gave them good news and bad news. Do you think they'll respond? Do you think they'll repent? Do you think they'll have a change of heart? We shall see. Kind of reminds me of something else. Going back to high school again. Remember, there was this guy who was a friend of mine. He came to school and he had these big dark sunglasses on. And immediately everybody was like, "Take those off." And then he did. He had a big black eye. He had gotten into a fight over the weekend and somebody popped him. His whole face was swollen, so he had the sunglasses on to cover it up. And I kind of laughed because I thought, did the sunglasses cover the eye or draw attention to it? Sometimes injustice does the same thing. We try and cover it up, but in the process, in covering it up, we make it worse because it even draws more attention to it, like a black eye. Because the truth is, whether the glasses are on or off, it'll be revealed and people will see what we're doing. We're going to look at verses 6 through 10, and I want you to tie in those six steps for repentance and see that if God is going to relent, they're going to have to repent, have a change of heart. But again, remember, these are the six things. Will it be the sight of sin? Will they recognize what they're doing? The prophet had told them. Would they be sorry for it? Because it's one thing to see it, but would they be sorrowful for it? Would there be a confession that they've been wrong? Would there be shame for it after confessing it? And then would they hate that sin and resolve not to do it anymore? And then ultimately, six, turn from that sin and turn back to God. Well, verses 6 through 10 will highlight that for us. Beginning with verse 6, this is from a New Living Translation. Now, this is what the Lord says concerning Judah's royal palace. I love you as much as fruitful Gilead and the green forest of Lebanon, but I will turn you into a desert with no one living within your walls. I will call for wreckers or destroyers, the Babylonians, who will bring out their tools to dismantle you. They will tear out all your fine cedar beams and throw them on the fire. People from many nations will pass by the ruins of this city and say to one another, "Why did the Lord destroy such a great city?" And the answer will be, "Because they violated their covenant with their Lord their God by worshiping other gods." And then 10. Do not weep for the dead king, or mourn his loss. Instead, weep for the captive king being led away, for he never will return to his native land again. That's what's coming. Is that enough to make them repent? Because if you go back to 1 through 5, there is an out. One last chance where God is saying, if you have a change of heart, change your heart condition, gain heart knowledge of me and switch it from your head, I will change my mind. And it's not a trick because, remember, God has done this before. We saw last week, Deacon White mentioned Hezekiah, that he turned towards the wall, gave him 15 more years. Once God told Moses, I'm so tired of these people, I'm going to wipe them all out and start with you. And Moses said, no. Remember what you said. You said that you would bring them out and make a mighty nation of them. What would people think of that? And God relented. Not that we can trick him, but when we have a true heart knowledge of what he says and who he is, he'll respond to us. But the question is Judah going to respond to these words? Well, as we look at it, as you look at 6 through 10, what we just read, it's not a pretty picture. The city in ruins, smashed up, broken, the beautiful cedars of Lebanon and all the different things that are in the temples and in the palace everywhere, those things are going to be gone. But it's based on three things. The indictment against them, the charge, is that, number one, they abandoned the covenant. Pretty serious stuff. You go all the way back to the beginning, back to the books of the law, that the covenant was their agreement with God, that they said that they would keep it, and they have failed miserably. Two, worshiping other gods. And then three, not only worshiping them, but serving them, offering sacrifices to them, and doing things on their behalf, even putting temples and idols of other things within the temple of the Lord. If you go back and you look in the book of Kings, you'll even see that when Josiah was king, they found the old books of the law and the covenant, and it hadn't been read in years since the day of the judges. He even talks about tearing out shrines within the Lord's temple. He even had offices for male and female prostitutes for sexual practices inside the temple. So if you're thinking that's disgusting, that's why the Lord is angry. They've pretty much destroyed any semblance of relationship, and they have no idea who he is in their hearts. And as you look at that, and as we work our way through, verse 6 really gives us a glimpse that although the house of the king of Judah is precious to God, it's his chosen land, it's prime real estate. We learned a couple weeks ago that Jesus wept over Jerusalem, that Jerusalem held a special place. It's not just a city, it's the embodiment of God dwelling with his people. This is not what God wants. But if you recognize that by the burning down of it, by burning things, you burn away what's dead and then allow something to be reborn and grow. It can't stay the way that it is. And I would dare say the world that we live in today, it cannot stay the way that it is. Not only was the house of Judah valued by God, they devalued it by worshiping other gods and idols, and as I mentioned, some of the behavior that they were doing. They didn't keep their covenant. Judah had enslaved itself and tied itself to the things of this world. If you look at verse 10, it kind of reminds us that in one way, this was worse than being dead. I'm going to read that again. If you look at that, do not weep for the dead king or mourn his loss. Instead, weep for the captive king. And that sounds strange, because the point is, if he's dead, not too much you can do for him. But to be taken away from Jerusalem and marched all the way to Babylon. Remember, if they surrendered, they would live. And as they're being marched out, they're going to miss. They're going to be gone about 70 years. So for many of them, they'll never see Jerusalem again. Children will be born and know nothing of Jerusalem. But the good news is that God said that he would restore them, but it can't stay the way that it is. While they're gone, if they truly desire justice that they're incapable of doing or they won't do now, will they get a heart transplant while they're gone? Will they exchange a heart of stone for one of flesh? Unrepentant, stony hearts lead to all sorts of things. In fact, if you go back to Isaiah 29:13, you might want to jot that down. We're reminded of this. The prophet says, and so the Lord says, these people say they're mine. Deacon White pointed out last week, we claim to be Christians, but are we? Are we Christians in name or in deed? Are we covenant keepers or covenant breakers? Do we have head knowledge versus heart knowledge? Because Isaiah 29:13 says, these people say they're mine. They honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. And their worship of me is nothing but man-made rules learned by rote. Plain church. In fact, Jesus even talked about it himself. Matthew 15:7-9. He actually quotes Isaiah and says, he's arguing with the Pharisees and the keepers of the law, the same kinds of people that were ruling in Judah before the exile. He says, you hypocrites, Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you. For he wrote, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. Their worship is a farce, a joke. For they teach man-made ideas as commands from God. He wasn't pleased then, and he's not pleased now. Injustice and the failing of understanding God in our hearts and dying to ourselves is damaging to the kingdom. It's a short lesson, but it's a powerful one. And I want you to think about a few things throughout your week. Why is it important that the prophet mentions David when he speaks against what's going on in Judah? What does David represent? Remember who David was and the promise that was made to David, and then through Solomon, and then ultimately up to this point, that if they keep the covenant, what does David have to do with this? I also want you to think about this. Whom does Jeremiah directly address in this prophecy? Who can hear his word? Because remember when he came in, it would be customary to whisper to the king, but who did he talk to this time to make sure there was no misunderstanding? We like to do that today. You think about Moses. When Moses went to the mountain, everybody was supposed to purify themselves and clean themselves up and come to the mountain and hear the commandments that God had. And then the people said, no, Moses, you go. Because the trick is, we don't want to be responsible. Because if somebody else hears it and we don't, we can blame it on them. But that doesn't work. Heart knowledge, head knowledge. We talked before that the Lord had previously told the Israelites his name was jealousy. And we talked just a few moments ago about all the things that Judah had done and why the Lord was angry and jealous, which he reaffirms here. Yet in our culture today, sometimes we still think jealousy is a negative, but there's a reason why God has to move them out and move them on. I want you to think about the opportunities that you have in your prayer life and think about what you're going to pray about this week, about maybe what you need to repent from and change. Have a change of heart. If David's descendants wouldn't renounce injustice, what would happen? And if they did, would God bless them? Good news, bad news. If they don't, what is the punishment? Being removed and sent to Babylon? And when would Judah come back? And again, some of the more lessons further on will get into that. But if you are going to repent, remember, visualize again turning 180 degrees. Think about why that matters. When we're turned away from God, we cannot hear him or see him well. He's speaking to us, but if we're turned with our backs to him, we can't really hear him. Our ears aren't designed that way. We can't see his face. Our minds are focused. We're focused on something else. But if we repent and we decide to turn from our wicked ways and turn 180 degrees back to him, face to face, he beckons and calls for us to return back to him. We can see him and hear him clearly. And the closer that we walk to him, the better we see and hear. That's what we see in this lesson today. If they'll repent, if they'll turn, but will they? And as we get ready to close, I think you know what your homework is. Think about those steps. How do you move from being unrepentant to repentant? How do you Take the good news, the bad news that the Lord offers. How will you move on it? How will you have a change of heart from a stony heart to a heart of flesh? I once heard a story where a little boy said, somebody was talking about this very thing, and he said, oh, I get it. And they said, well, you're kind of young. How do you make sense of that? And he stood up and he said, well, it's like there's two people in my heart. And when people knock, I have to decide who answers the door in my heart. Is it Jesus or is it me? When Jesus answers the knocking in our heart daily, we can live justly and treat people the way that God intended. We do live in an unrepentant generation and time. Today's lessons prove that we have a choice to accept the good news or the bad news. In every heart, there's a throne and a cross. Let the King of Kings take his rightful place on his throne. Remember tomorrow as you celebrate Memorial Day. Remember those that made the ultimate sacrifice on the battlefield. But also remember the King that died for you on a cross so that you could mirror his sacrifice daily and surrender your old life for his new one. Let him take his rightful place. Seek his face. Turn from your wicked ways and repent, and see justice, true justice, pervade the land and prevail. That, my friends, is the good news. Let us pray. Eternal God, thank you for this day and this opportunity. Thank you again that your word, that it could go forth. There are many who are behind bars, either physically or in their mind, or separated from a church where the Bible is being taught. Father, we pray that again that we would be willing vessels. More importantly, before we go, we need to know. We pray again that your word would saturate each and every one of us and it would dwell deeply and richly within us. Father, I thank you again for this church. I thank you again for my brothers and sisters. Keep them in good health and in good stead. But Father, as we prepare to come back to be about your business, let these lessons truly be our marching orders. Bless us and keep us like only you can. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.